On this episode of America's Port, stolen explosives put port police on a high terrorist alert.
Los Angeles Port Police, anybody aboard?
A security breach forces the Coast Guard to close a terminal.
Time is money.
Who's the guy in charge?
Deadly toxins could threaten lives. The Port of Los Angeles, the busiest container port in the country. But not all imported goods enter inside these steel cans. More than 3 million tons of loose cargo, called break bulk, arrives here annually.
Compared to a container operation, a break bulk operation is much more labor intensive.
From fruit ships filled with perishable produce on tight deadlines.
That's good.
To auto ships offloading 140,000 cars annually.
So we'll get another one.
A never-ending flow of cargo streams in round the clock. And among these giant vessels, commercial fishermen try to make a living. Captain John Dorio sails from the port toward Malibu on the hunt for a local favorite, calamari or squid.
Sundown is when most of the time the squid comes to the surface.
But he's not alone looking for tasty fish. Sea lions try to steal his catch.
They chase us on the deck. They try to attack us.
They come in out of the net. Jump over the corks, jump in, jump out. I call them dogs, perro.
And we get a lot of seals around our nets, in the nets, and they eat the squid, is what we're fishing for.
But Dorio knows sea lions have a place at the port, just as he does.
Sometimes we feed sea lions, sometimes we feed ourselves. Everybody gets fed. Birds, sea lions, nobody gets left behind.
Using a common deterrent, fishermen detonate small explosives known as seal bombs.
The purpose of the seal control device is to warn off the seals away from the catch and also the nets, because these fishermen, when they get their nets in, the seals come up and eat at the fish and also eat through their nets, releasing their catch for the day.
These explosives are closely monitored by port police. While seal bombs chase seals from nets, they also bring a bigger threat to the port. Since 9/11, the port police regulate the purchase and storage of seal bombs in an effort to keep them out of the hands of terrorists.
Gathering enough seal control devices to make a large device is something I think terrorists would think of.
As night falls, Dorio and his crew get a treasure trove of squid. For the 15 commercial fishing boats calling the port home, fishing is good.
This guy's already got 50 ton of fish on a boat.
In the 1940s, the Los Angeles Harbor was the largest tuna port in the world. Over the years, the waters were fished out. Big companies moved on to other ports, leaving small fishing vessels like the St. Catherine in their wake.
Right ahead.
Tonight, Captain John Dorio's nets are full.
A lot of sea lions in there.
He uses seal bombs to protect his catch.
What I'm gonna do here is throw a few seal control. They're like an M80. Okay, stand by.
After the explosives scare seals out of the net,
calamari.
The crew hauls in their catch and their dinner.
Excellent calamari. What's that? The hell's that?
Residents in the mountain called multiple shots fired offshore.
No shots, probably seal controls.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's why we pulled.
Yeah, that's all. Right. Probably seal controls. Here's my license.
Okay. seal bombs alone, right?
Yeah,
just
that's
out here capping rounds.
Yeah,
that. What it was five in rapid succession.
Yeah, I heard that. They take the sand out, right? I was explaining. They take the sand out of the bomb, and it floats. So it's on the surface, and it makes a big bang, you know. But
because it wasn't individual, because it was in rapid succession.
Right.
That's why we respond.
Right. Exactly.
We don't know what's going on out here.
Last time they took my documents from me, I ended up in jail in Catalina Island.
AM, long before cars gridlocked the streets of Los Angeles. Traffic jams the waterways of the harbor. More than 20 ships await entry into the port.
This is our freeway. This is our rush hour. But it's still dark when we're doing our rush hour.
Captain Michael Rubino races out to pilot his first ship of the day, the Canoed Lauritsen. This refrigerated vessel, called a fruiter, carries 58,000 cases of Chilean produce, destined for Super Bowl celebrations across the country. Rubino's mission, board the massive fruit ship and guide her into port. There's only one problem. The 55,000-ton Ever Divine blocks the entrance to the port.
The Ever Divine is over to the east in the Canoed Lauritsen with a bright light. It's just off our port bow. The Canoed Lauritsen is overtaking the Ever Divine. So we've asked Ever Divine to slow down just a little bit and the Canoed Lauritsen to speed up a little bit.
Averting collision by increasing speed creates another problem for Rubino. He must leap from the pilot boat to the fruit ship while both are moving faster than usual. Once aboard, Rubino takes over the con, or control of the vessel.
Securité, all station Los Angeles, Canoed Lauritsen, we're inbound, passing number 3. The Ever Divine that we're passing, that's the last of our traffic until we get up towards the dock. Steady.
Having piloted 7,000 vessels over 2 decades, Rubino knows this harbor.
We're coming to the bridge now. We have to go up the East Basin Channel and around the corner. That's where our docking area is at berth 212.
The Back Basin is the first stop of the day for this fruiter, which transports produce in containers above deck and in loose cartons below.
The cargo is a lot of mixed fruits, and we have onions also and avocados. They're building up their supplies here for the Super Bowl.
At this terminal, crane operators will offload the refrigerated containers, known as reefers. Rubino is done for now, but he'll return later in the day to pilot this ship back down the main channel to a terminal that specializes in offloading loose fruit and vegetables. Today, they have 58,000 cartons of perishable goods that must get to stores quickly. But an unforeseen delay threatens to destroy the produce.
We're to stop this job.
We have to stop the wood.
Who's responsible for it?
Who's the guy in charge?
Captain Dorio returns to the port. It was a good night for the St. Catherine. The haul, 8 tons of squid, valued at $600 a ton. But there's trouble brewing at the commercial fishing dock. Stolen from a moored boat, 3,000 seal bombs, the equivalent of 375 sticks of dynamite.
When we came out, we discovered the large number of seal control devices were stolen from there, which has been an ongoing concern over here. We're trying to do our efforts to keep these things from being stolen and possibly fall in the hands of terrorists.
Also missing, 2 weeks' supply of food from a locked freezer, costing the boat's captain $2,000.
The freezer's cleaned out now, and chain cutters are right there on the floor. He cut the lock off the freezer. He knew what he was doing.
Right. The suspect possibly cut his hand or another part of his body, and he left a blood trail inside the boat. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to get some samples of blood and send them to the lab.
Detective Bilo gathers evidence and dusts the crime scene for fingerprints. Since 9/11, when explosives go missing, it must be treated as a possible terrorist threat.
When the seal control devices are stolen, we immediately go into a counterterrorism mode. Because these are a class one explosive, we go ahead and make all of our notifications to Homeland Security. We also step up our inspections out here, both land and waterside.
Get them. Get them. Get them. Nail them.
Detective Bilo gathers a task force to track the missing explosives and possibly stop an attack on the port.
Port police coming down.
4 p.m. at the Houston Container Terminal. After offloading reefers filled with Chilean produce, the Knud Lauritsen is restocked with empty cans or containers and ready to move to its next destination, the fruit terminal at the other end of the port.
Hello again, pilot, how are you?
Port pilot Captain Michael Rubino boards the ship for the second time.
Hello again, Captain. How are you, sir? Good. Now we're going to bring the principal cargo, which is the fruit, over to the Outer Harbor fruit dock. She'll discharge everything there and then head back down to South America.
Rubino must guide the Knud Lauritsen from one end of the port to the other. And there's a lot of twisting and turning for the 539-foot vessel.
It's going to be a little bit interesting. It's going to be some maneuvering. So.
We're going to turn around, do a 180 in the East Basin, go to the Outer Harbor, turn around again, and back up into the Outer Harbor berth 55 starboard side also. So we're making two turns, one at the start, one at the finish. Securité all station of Los Angeles, Knud Lauritsen, preparing to depart LA berth 212. Be turning in the East Basin, outbound for berth 55 Outer Harbor.
The large vessel turns easily without the aid of tugboats, thanks to its bow and stern thrusters.
The Knud Lauritsen is equipped with bow and stern thruster. Both are 1,200 horsepower each. The bow thruster acts like an impeller in a pump, and it shoots water laterally from one side to the other. You can direct the flow of the water. And the slower the ship goes, the more efficient the thruster is. The faster the ship, the less efficient.
Rubino makes the 180-degree turn and starts his cautious passage through the channel.
We'll be going by 191 here shortly.
Yeah, I'll get the call.
Thank you. Let's keep her down at below 5 knots until we get past the bunker barge, then we can kick it up to 6 knots. Whoa.
But in the tight basin, trouble ahead.
We got a deep draft sailboat up there. Give him another prolonged blast of whistle caps so he knows we're coming.
It's not a good idea to sail between a docked vessel and a freighter, but the sailboat doesn't change its course.
I'm not certain what that other ship is doing, and I'm going to do everything I can to avoid collision. Midship. It's remarkable that as large as these ships are, some of these guys on small boats are so engrossed in what they're doing, they don't even see you. By blowing the whistle, he's looking up and seeing us and knows to move out of the way.
Quick maneuvering in a narrow basin.
As soon as we get past this barge, we can kick it up to 6 knots, head back over to the center of the...
But the challenge isn't over. Rubino must make his second tight turn with the massive ship.
Coming up on this slip right in here, and we're going to come off a reservation point and spin off of this point here. But this is an older chart. It hasn't been corrected. It still shows the shoal here. The shoal has all been dredged. So we've got 55 feet of water in this area where it shows 20 feet. That's something the pilot would know, but if you were just looking at this chart, you wouldn't know.
As he passes his boss's office, he compares their workspace.
This office not only has a 360-degree view, it moves. And I will invite Dr. Nance anytime she wants to come and ride on a ship with the LA Port Pilots, she is welcome.
Executive Director of the Port, Dr. Geraldine Nance, has ridden the giant vessels. She's even climbed the Jacob's Ladder at a neighboring port.
It's an e-ticket ride. The sun coming up, oh, it's like fabulous. Of course, with Mike, it doesn't count that I did it at Long Beach. I haven't done it with our pilots. But, you know, I can't go on a day when it's whipping around. You know, I'm going to be in the drink there, so.
As Rubino's boss and head of the port, Dr. Nats has many duties and one ongoing pledge.
Secure the port and defend the nation.
Today at the port, emergency crews are doing just that. An explosion rocks the port rail yard. But this one was planned. It's the largest hazmat drill ever run at the port, evacuating 1,100 people in minutes. Today, this is only a drill. But with 43% of the nation's imports coming through the port complex, a spill or biological attack could shut it down. Dr. Nats arrives at the site to survey the drill's effectiveness.
Once these members go into the hazardous material area, the hot zone, they need to be decontaminated.
In an area of a port like this, where so much of the cargo we handle is hazardous cargo, these types of exercises are really invaluable.
And timely, as in the case of this real anthrax scare. The ports of Los Angeles and Long Beach are on alert. This empty cargo container tries to enter a terminal. Spray painted on the side are the words Osama and anthrax inside.
We will be making an entry.
Hazmat crews move in to test for the deadly toxin.
Be advised there may be a downwind.
The port PD response occur yet.
They need you to assist with the hazmat entry operation. Yeah.
Although it's negative for anthrax, it's a chilling reminder of the importance of emergency preparedness. At the Port of Los Angeles, as port police search the commercial fishing dock for missing explosives, this man gets caught in the dragnet.
You're not running from the police anymore, right?
Contraband is found on his boat. But there's a way he can beat the rap. Thousands of seal bombs have been stolen off a moored boat. Detective Mike Bilo of the Port Police assembles a task force to search every boat in the fishing marina.
If anybody finds anything of significance, please call me before you guys go in and touch it.
What do you consider significant? What quantity was?
I know for sure one vessel has 12 cases, so they probably have 18,000 seal bombs on them. All right, Team A is going to start off on this dock. Team B is going to hit the other side of the dock.
You know, guys, just a reminder, these are explosives. So, you know, don't be booting them around, dropping them, anything like that.
All right, guys, be safe.
The search begins.
Hey, are you the captain?
No. Do you know where the captain is right now?
Where do you keep the seal bombs on this boat?
Down there, the bunk room.
This is already in violation of several codes on how to properly store a seal bomb.
The explosives must be locked in a storage bin.
Anything else on this boat?
That's it.
Any weapons, anything else like that? No, okay, cool. All right, let's go up to the bridge.
All right, so we're going to sight you right now, and we're going to take the seal control devices.
On several boats, officers find seal bombs out in the open, violating storage regulations and making them easily accessible to terrorists.
Yeah, there's probably about 30 pieces just sitting there loosely.
Yeah, but there's probably more boxes.
The senior lead officer, Octo, found 5 boxes of seal control devices on the second boat that we inspected on this side of the dock. And we're going to seize the items.
The explosives are confiscated to keep them out of the wrong hands.
I'll take the case.
This is exactly what we're out here looking for. These are seal control devices.
We're starting to take it for that man's turn.
Yes, I think that's what he wants to handle it.
Ready for the next?
Suddenly, a call from the other side of the dock.
Phone 130 at the office.
Roger, ma'am.
Officers boarding a fishing vessel encounter crew members who will not let them inside the cabin.
We're moving.
Milo and his men rush to provide backup. Port pilot Captain Michael Rubino has successfully maneuvered the Knud Lauritzen through a crowded channel. He now eyes his next challenge, backing the massive fruiter down a narrow basin.
We're gonna make our turn right in here. Put the stern to the dock and then back in. Good. Once we get past, we can start straightening out a little. We've got the ship in position now to start backing up into the slip. And you can see how narrow the opening is. See where the truck is down there? It's about in the middle of the warehouse. We're gonna go.
As the sun sets over the port, Rubino and the crew carefully steer the 80-foot wide vessel down the 350-foot wide basin.
Backing up the east channel, and we're slowly heading back there. And we'll start running spring lines. Probably about another 10 minutes, 15 minutes, we'll have our lines out, and our job will be over.
At the fruit terminal, longshoremen await the perishable cargo.
We handle 100% of the Chilean produce that comes into the west coast of the United States. That's from the west coast all the way east of the Mississippi. So it's quite a bit of volume.
I'm in communication with the port pilot up on the ship, giving the signal to let him know that the vessel is berthed where we want it to be.
In position, Captain.
At last, she's alongside. As Rubino heads off to pilot yet another ship, longshoremen start the process of offloading the fruiter.
We'll be discharging roughly 6,000 pallets off the Knud Lauritzen while she's in port here. She'll be working roughly 3 days.
Before the offload can begin, security protocol must be followed.
Chief mate,
you check the cargo books? Can you sign in?
All righty.
Everyone who boards the ship must sign in and show ID. The Coast Guard arrives for a random security inspection.
Hold up there a second.
And uncovers a serious breach. There are too many people aboard and not enough signatures. To the Coast Guard, this could mean there are stowaways.
Sometimes they do surprise inspections. If they find something wrong with the ship, they can shut down everything.
Time is money. Time is money. If we're to stop, I'll be glad to stop. Who's responsible for it?
Who's the guy in charge?
You?
Although the cargo is perishable, neither fruit nor forklifts are going anywhere.
The ramifications of this security issue could run into the thousands of dollars.
the Port of Los Angeles is on a terrorist alert due to stolen explosives called SEAL bombs.
When the SEAL control devices are stolen, we immediately go into a counterterrorism mode because these are a class one explosive. Gathering enough SEAL control devices to make a large device is something I think terrorists would think of.
And at the fruit ship terminal, perishable produce sits and work is at a standstill while the Coast Guard investigates a security breach. Workers boarded the ship without following sign-in procedures.
We got the gangway up, and I don't know, we can't say anything till we know what's happening.
So I don't know what's happening right here. I got no idea. They just said something about the Coast Guard being up there.
In blue jumpsuits and white hard hats, Coast Guard officers supervise the security sign-in process.
When we come on the ship, we have to sign on.
Sure. Okay. Part of getting onto the terminals, you have to show IDs. You come in the gate, you have to show IDs. You come up onto the ship. But I guess they just didn't log it properly, so they decided they had to shut the job down and have everybody come up and sign in and just do things the proper way, I suppose.
Just bring people, whoever you have loose right now, start like, logging them in.
You're all right down here in the line. See? Everybody's in the line. We're going to start it. We're going to go one at a time back to work.
Is that okay for the...
To us, the way we look at it, time is money. If the ship were to stop, and it takes a half hour to 45 minutes, that could make the difference. Us finishing on time or overtime.
Once all workers are ID'd and logged in properly, the Coast Guard allows the gangway to be lowered.
Hey, okay, you can stop loading.
That's working.
Let's go to work!
Well, the issue we have between the Coast Guard and the vessel has been resolved. Crisis averted. Until the next crisis.
You guys are all certified drivers. You know what to do today. I don't want anybody to get hurt. Let's get going.
Longshoremen kick into gear. Hatch covers open. Below, massive refrigerator doors unfold, exposing 6,000 pallets of produce stored at 32 degrees to the open air.
If we leave the fruit too long on the ship, it's going to rot. So you want to take it off the fastest, most efficient way possible.
The mission, get the fruit to the warehouse and onto refrigerated trucks before the fruit's temperature rises 10 degrees. And the ripening process begins.
In order to protect what they call the cold chain, we get it off the floor as soon as possible and into the trucks. Keeps it at a certain temperature. And that's the whole thing, is to keep the temperature constant. You don't want the temperature to go up, go down, go up, go down. Just keep it the same.
The clock starts ticking. Now. First, the cargo in the center is pulled out using a pre-slung cage, a steel top with flexible straps that brace the cargo and pallets.
Once they get the square cleared out, all the pre-slung spreaders come out, there's enough room to land a cage, we'll bring a forklift in, start opening the square up a little bit more, put another lift in when we get space, and then as they open it up, put another lift in, so we get three lifts in there, production numbers will start going up.
This is a break bulk operation, loose cargo that has to be moved off the ship individually, which makes unloading the Knud Lorentzen a unique challenge.
It's a little more labor intensive, you're more hands-on here. Sometimes it's more dangerous also. The loads can break, things can shift on you. And if they have ice everywhere around here, it's a real dangerous job.
Just one step at a time, just be careful what you're doing and everything should be fine. Stay safe.
In break bulk ops, cranes are built into the ship, unlike dock cranes and container terminals. The Knud Lorentzen works five cranes simultaneously, the largest capable of heaving 36 tons of cargo.
All right, come on back, Yogi. Once it's here, we'll pull the cord to release the straps on it. And when it's all clear, I'll give the driver the signal to pick up. Right now, I'm going to clear all the straps all the way so the forklift driver can come in and get a clean shot.
Forklifts move the cartons from the dock to their designated grid on the warehouse floor.
That's good, yeah.
Next, a physical inventory is done.
This scanner scans the barcode and it tells you exactly where to put it at. But it's been pre-programmed already before it even gets off the ship.
Each stack is labeled, indicating where it will go for pickup.
The numbers mean the location where we're gonna load them at, and that's where they pick them up with the truckers.
Once the produce is scanned and sorted, forklifts rush the pallets into refrigerated trucks. Despite the security snag, longshoremen are back on schedule.
We lost a little bit of time with the issue that we had, but we made some adjustments. Productivity is good, so we're still on schedule to finish the vessel tomorrow on the day side.
The gangs will work all night to finish moving the perishable shipment.
I have two gangs coming in tonight to continue with the discharge, and then we have three gangs on schedule for tomorrow to finish the discharge.
If all goes well, this produce will leave the dock fresh and ready for stores. In the commercial fishing marina, the search is on for missing seal bombs. Officers may board vessels at any time for safety inspections. Another call comes in. Occupants of one particular boat won't respond to port police.
Valley Port Police, anybody on board?
I heard somebody. When they knocked on the vessel, nobody answered, but they did hear a little bit of movement inside. So the officers went ahead and started their inspection.
Coming aboard. Port police coming down.
They found two men aboard inside the living quarters, which they detained and brought off the vessel.
So, I was dead asleep.
He's all right. He's dead.
Well, they're both claiming that they're sleeping, so unlikely we were this close to them, yelling at them. I'm a pretty hard sleeper, but not that hard.
The two men are detained while officers search the cabin.
I just got out on parole about 4 days ago, so I shouldn't be under arrest. I wouldn't see why I would be, but...
Both men have spent time in jail for drug possession. Any drugs found on board could put them back behind bars.
I'm looking for any illegal weapons, narcotics paraphernalia, additional seal control devices, anything that the person's not supposed to have.
Okay, seal bombs. I see one open box up there. Do you have any more than that anywhere else?
I don't think so. I don't know.
No missing explosives. This man's bunk is cleared. Nothing illegal found. But this man's bunk is a different story. Officer Shunkey finds illegal contraband.
It's basically what's left over of his marijuana. We'll see what else we got. Here you go. Got a meth pipe. Apparently, he likes methamphetamine and sea turtles. Actually, not too bad. If he spent more time working on something productive like this, he probably wouldn't be going to jail. Little adult entertainment. Wow. Lot of adult entertainment.
It's very common where there's meth, amphetamine, there's a lot of porn. Always is. For some reasons, they go hand in hand.
Shunkey interrogates one of the men.
Aboard your vessel right now, you're on parole, correct?
Yeah, he can go too.
Aboard your vessel right now, you have marijuana, methamphetamine residue, methamphetamine smoking device.
This is news to me.
Okay. Well, and the bunk room smells like marijuana in the first place.
This is supposed to be gone from this boat. Yeah, that's the only reason I'm not aboard it is because I was guaranteed that, you know, nobody's using dope on that.
With no evidence linking him to drugs, this man is let go. But the other suspect may still end up behind bars.
I'm talking to Bilo right now because I want to roll him up. I'm going to send him back to the pen.
Okay.
He's not learning his lesson.
Just prior to sundown at the Port of Los Angeles, Chief Port Pilot Michael Robino is off to pilot another ship.
We're underway on the pilot boat, heading out for the Andromeda Spirit. The Andromeda Spirit's about 3.5 miles from the pilot boarding ground now. She really stands high out of the water.
The Andromeda Spirit is an auto ship carrying 1,800 new cars from Japan. she began her journey at the Oppama plant in Japan, where exports were prepped in the lot. And cars were loaded and secured to avoid movement at sea. Then the ship sailed 11 days to Los Angeles. And now it's here for Robino to guide it into port.
We're alongside the Andromeda Spirit, and as you can see, we're in the lee, this large steel mast is knocking out all the wind and most of the swell. But it's relatively calm where we are right now aboard the pilot.
Robino climbs aboard using the Jacob's ladder.
We made it again. Oh, and it's got that new car smell.
The bridge is five decks above. An elevator takes Robino up.
Good evening, Captain. Thank you for having us aboard. My name is Robino. 015, slow ahead. Wow, brand new ship. Hit ship.
Hey, ship.
Steady.
Steady.
Andromeda Spirit to the tugs.
Robino gets assistance from two tugboats, the Sander and the Morgan.
We're off the pilot station, coming your way. And...
okay, then we'll put Morgan, center lead aft, Sander Hugh, port bow.
Roger on the Sander. Roger on Morgan.
City on 3-4-5.
3-4-5.
Robino pilots the vessel through the 2-mile-long channel and under the Vincent Thomas Bridge en route to the carship terminal.
Make a safe passage with a ship that's 3 football fields long, in the dark, coming down a narrow channel. This is what it's all about. This is what the pilots get paid to do. Steady.
Steady.
Robino pilots a 180-degree turn in the channel and backs the 44,000-ton vessel into dock.
Captain, keep the distance coming on the starboard quarter. I'm better at parking ships than I am at parking cars. I don't want to scratch your brand new ship yet. Spring lines first, Captain, fore and aft, please.
The Andromeda is secured using spring lines, 200 feet of rope weighing over 50 pounds attached to the side of the vessel. The ropes hold her tightly to the dock while longshoremen secure her from bow and stern.
Stop engine.
Stop engine.
The tugs release the gigantic rope from the stern. His third job of the day complete, Robino heads home. In the morning, longshoremen drive the cars off the ship and into the port's vehicle processing plant, where they will be detailed, accessorized, and stickered. At the car terminal, 40 longshoremen get last-minute instructions before boarding the Andromeda Spirit to drive off the latest models.
Racing to the yard, make sure you take care of these vehicles. No eating in the cars, no drinking coffee in the cars, no cell phones in the cars. Drive at a nice safe speed and we'll work safely today.
Lashers responsible for freeing cars from the ship get an earful too.
The last 3 lashing jobs. People have 50 cars lashed up. The time before that, they dropped 75 cars, whatever it was supposed to be dropped. I don't want to hear he did it, she did it, they did it. Take care of the job. Your professionals take care of it.
That's right.
Sounds simple. I'll be up to run the first set of cars, guys. It's going to work.
Okay.
Lashers board before the drivers. Their task, pull the lashing straps from 1,800 cars. With 40 drivers coming in behind them, they have to hurry. They crawl between cars like spiders pulling down their webs, covered in plastic to protect the cars from scratches. With the ship's cargo unlashed, it's time to drive the cars off the ship. 10-year longshoreman vet John Iacono heads aboard for his first car of the morning.
Car number one, here we go, start the day. See, we have Flag Eagle pointing us in every direction out here. And then we have spotters, they tell us where to stop the car. Let's go get another one.
Maria Espinosa is in her eighth year as a longshoreman.
This ship is a good ship. Some of these ships, you could smell the fumes really bad. This one's okay, because there's a lot of air blowing. But you go up and down the ramps and you get pretty sick.
Two cars off, 1,798 to go.
We do about a car, what, every 5 minutes or so?
Yeah.
Something like that. Man comes, picks us up, takes us back on the ship. We get another car and go back in the parking lot. Let's continue this merry-go-round.
It'll be a light day. With a maximum capacity of 3,000 cars, the Andromeda Spirit is just over half full.
All right, here we go. One thing about driving these cars on a Sado ship is there's a lot of things you can hit, a lot of pillars, a lot of sliding when you're making turns, but it's a zero tolerance policy. If you happen to bump anything, a pillar, or if you happen to bump another car, or if you scratch anything, you're fired. I mean, there's no really questions about it. Another one.
6 p.m. After nearly 10 hours, the 1,800 cars are off the ship on schedule. Now, a processing center adds accessories for the American market.
We process vehicles that are made in Japan for all of the dealers west of the Mississippi. Throw-ins, which would normally be floor mats, cargo protectors, mud flaps or splash guards, spoilers, iPod adapters, illuminated kick plates.
Once stickered, these cars are ready to ship to dealers.
Vehicles are trucked to dealers and sent out on rail cars, and we process about 140,000 vehicles per year.
And they're off. While searching the commercial fishing dock for thousands of stolen seal bombs,
Port Police coming down.
Port Police find a crew member in a bunk where illegal contraband is hidden.
Got a meth pipe.
Detective Mike Bilow and Officer Shunky discuss the suspect's fate.
Are you strong-hearted about taking this guy to jail, or do you want to sign him up to see if he can work for us?
If we can make him a friend instead of an enemy, I think that'd be the best thing.
Good.
By friend, he means an informant, or teammate in Port Police terminology. Someone on the inside who will provide info on crimes, such as the theft of seal bombs.
You're gonna go in my OE book. It's 3 for 1, though. You gotta give me 3 good ones. I drive down here all the time. So I'll be jacking you up just to talk to you, or to jack you up for real, make sure you're not screwing around.
The next time.
Although the search doesn't yield the missing explosives, the Port Police will have another pair of eyes on the lookout for seal bomb thefts and more.
Currently, we're asking help from the public to identify the suspects in this crime. Any information, please contact Los Angeles Port Police Crime Stoppers Hotline. The telephone number is 1-888-LA-PORT-PD.
After the successful hazmat drill, Dr. Geraldine Natz has some lighter duties to attend to.
I like to take a break and kind of interact with people. That's the fun part.
Dressed in attire from the 1900s for the port's 100th anniversary, Dr. Natz and her family ride in a holiday parade.
I'm working on my email.
In old-fashioned garb, she works with modern technology.
So, like, here I am in a 1900 outfit with my cell phone, so.
My schedule is packed. I do run from one thing to the next, and as I'm doing that, I'm trying to work. You know, sometimes I carry work around with me every place I go.
After 100 years of progress and economic livelihood, it's time to celebrate the dawn of the harbor's next century. Refrigerated trucks transport Super Bowl fruit to supermarkets. cars arrive at dealerships ready for their final destination, American Driveways. And thousands work night and day to keep valuable cargo flowing through America's ports.